Democracy, from the Greek demokratia. It joins two concepts, demos, the people, and kratia, power. It is a form of government in which the people have the authority to choose those who temporarily rule over them. If you're watching this video, it's most likely you live in an at least somewhat democratic society, a privilege that not all of the world has, and one we should thank those who lived before us, managed to fight for, and achieve. Most countries in the world are somewhat democratic, although some are not, and even within the democratic ones, there are differences. The level of democracy and of the perception people have varies. Now, it's important to state that this isn't my opinion. I'm going off the Democratic Index, made by the Economist Intelligence Unit. They are a UK-based company, which in this effort attempt to measure the state of democracy in 167 countries worldwide. They base it on 60 indicators spread amongst a few main categories. The categories are electoral process and pluralism, functioning of government, political participation, political culture, and civil liberties. Now, I couldn't find any description of the categories, but from my understanding, they are the following. Electoral process, I think, has to do with how elections are run, how many parties participate and exist, slash are elected, and how transparent elections are, plus if they accept international observers. Functioning of government, I assume, has to do with the type of measures governments take, and also if their governance is transparent. Political participation likely has to do with how many people vote and take part in political action. Political culture, I think, has to do with how strengthened the democracy is, meaning what type of institutions exist to ensure the existence of democracy and its maintenance, like the separation of powers, a system of checks and balances that prevents abuse of power, amongst others. And civil liberties must mean exactly that, the existence and assurance of civil liberties. By measuring how each country does in those categories, each country gets a score from 0 to 10. The closer the country is to 10, the more democratic it is, according to these analysts. The scores are divided into four general results. Full democracies, those who range from 8 to 10, these are nations where freedom and democracy aren't only respected, but reinforced by political culture and independent separation of powers, checks and balances. Flawed democracies, which range from 6 to 8, these have fair and free elections and basic civil liberties, but might have some issues with freedom of the press, for instance. Hybrid regimes, which range from 4 to 6, countries with issues that often prevent them from being fully fair and free democracies. They have low levels of political participation and issues with the functioning of governance. And authoritarian regimes, which range from 0 to 4, places where political freedom is non-existent or very limited. Out of the 167 countries evaluated, only 20 are full democracies, 55 are flawed democracies, 39 are hybrid, and 53 are authoritarian. I'm going to get into more detail, but before that, the reason why many of you probably clicked on the video, which are the top 10 most democratic and the bottom 10 least democratic countries in the world. According to this, the most democratic country in the world is Norway, with a score of 9.87 out of 10. But all the top 10, actually top 11, have a score of over 9. Iceland, Sweden, New Zealand, Finland, Ireland, Denmark and Canada, which are tied at number 7, Australia, Switzerland and the Netherlands. These 0 to 10 scores are, as I mentioned, an average of the results a country gets in each of those main 5 categories. There's an almost complete dominance of Western Europe in this top 11, filling 8 of the slots. North America has 1 and Oceania has 2. On the opposite end, we have the bottom 10, the least democratic countries in the world. The least democratic and therefore most authoritarian country is, according to this ranking, and Korea, with a score of 1.08. The other bottom 10 are the Democratic Republic of the Congo, the Central African Republic, Syria, Chad, Turkmenistan, Equatorial Guinea, Saudi Arabia and Tajikistan tie at the 159th place, and Yemen. Before we take a generalized overview of the entire world map, I'd like to point out a few countries that stand out due to their high or low results in the ranking. China ranks very low at 153rd with a score of 2.26. Their highest result is 4.29 in the functioning of government category. Venezuela is the only country in South America that is ranked as authoritarian with 2.88, although they do get a value of 5 in the political participation category and 4.38 in political culture. Turkey ranks at 110th and just makes it into the ranking as a hybrid regime with a score of 4.09. Worth remembering that any scores under 4 are considered authoritarian. They get scores of 3.08 and 2.35 in electoral process and civil liberties respectively, but those are pulled up to an average of 4 by getting 5.0 in each of the remaining three categories. Singapore, Hong Kong, Papua New Guinea, and Mexico get the worst results amongst the flawed democracies, while North Macedonia, Ukraine, Albania, and Bangladesh don't make it into the green by a matter of decimals. The best flawed democracies are South Korea, Japan, the United States, and Malta, which get great results, but still not enough to average their overall score as being over 8.0 and therefore seen as full democracies. Portugal is the first to make it into the full democracies category with a score of 8.03, just enough to make it, similar to Chile with 8.08 and France with 8.12. So now let's go over the entire map. Remember, within a green, the darker, the better. Then yellow is okay. As it gets orange, it gets less and less democratic. And red is full-on authoritarian, according to this ranking. America is a good example of almost total democracy, even if sometimes flawed. There are a few exceptions, but not that many. Only Guatemala, Honduras, Cuba, Haiti, Bolivia and Venezuela. Canada, Uruguay, Chile and Costa Rica are the best in the American continent, along with a few small Caribbean islands. In Europe, almost all is green, but we notice a few shades of yellow in the Balkans, in Bosnia, Kosovo, North Macedonia and Albania. In the East, Ukraine and Moldova too, while Belarus is full-on authoritarian and Russia gets a very dark tone of orange, almost reaching the red as well. Norse countries get the best results here, along with Switzerland, Ireland and the Netherlands, with a second top tier including Portugal, Spain, France, Germany, Austria and the UK. In Africa, we get the opposite situation. Green is rare and almost always very light. Cape Verde does well, just like South Africa and Botswana, Namibia, Ghana, and Tunisia. But all the rest just ranges from light yellow to dark red. However, we should keep in mind that the light yellow isn't necessarily bad. It just means that according to the people who made this ranking, there are a few aspects in which these countries' democracies aren't exactly fully functioning or ideally functioning. Throughout Asia, we get a true mosaic of colors as well. There are a lot of authoritarian countries, especially in the Middle East and Central Asia, with special attention to hybrid regimes in the Caucasus region. But a decent number are in the green as well. India, Sri Lanka, Mongolia, Thailand and Malaysia, Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, Indonesia, Hong Kong, and Singapore, with a few more hybrid regimes throughout as well, like Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Pakistan, amongst others. In Oceania, within the ones part of this ranking, they're pretty much entirely in the green, with the exception of the Fiji Islands, which are seen as hybrid. It's also important to understand how these countries have evolved over the past year. Now, this data, available in 2020, is from 2019, so from 2018 to 2019, there were some changes. The biggest growth and improvement was Thailand, which went up 38 places in the ranking. Armenia went up 17, Algeria 13, and Madagascar and Tunisia 10 each. However, some got worse. China went down 23 slots, Bolivia went down 21, Guyana 17, Benin 16, and even India, the world's biggest democracy, went down 10 places according to this ranking. Which doesn't necessarily mean their democracy got worse, it might just mean that 10 other countries surpassed them in terms of democracy quality. We obviously have to remember that these 5 criteria are somewhat subjective, and despite there being 60 indicators, their review might not always be accurate. So always keep critical thinking in mind when looking at these rankings, and don't take them for absolutely certain, especially when it comes to comparing one country with others from the perspective of external observers and not from the internal experience that their inhabitants have. Although I think this does provide us with a generalized overview of how each country fares in terms of how democratic their regimes are. When it comes to the individual category scores, very few countries get perfect results in any of them. Only 6 get a perfect 10 in the electoral process score: Norway, Iceland, New Zealand, Australia, Luxembourg, Uruguay, Denmark, Finland, and Ireland. Nobody gets a perfect score on functioning of government, and only Norway gets a 10 in political participation, with no one else even getting a 9. Norway, Iceland, Sweden, and Ireland get 10s in political culture, and only Ireland, Australia, and New Zealand get 10.0 in civil liberties. We can also see these results by region by averaging out all the countries' scores. Although in this case, regions with less countries might have a statistical benefit, and the organization they make of certain regions lacks logic, in my opinion. For instance, for this ranking, North America only consists of the US and Canada, while all the others in the American continent are grouped together as Latin America and the Caribbean, something that from my perspective doesn't make much sense. Because of this, North America is ranked the most democratic region in the world, with an 8.59 score. Western Europe follows at 8.35. Latin America and the Caribbean at 6.13. Asia and Australasia, including Oceania, are grouped together and rank fourth with 5.67, somewhat unfair to Oceania, which would rank higher alone and is effectively its own continent and region. Central and Eastern Europe follow with 5.42, next is Sub-Saharan Africa with 4.26, and in last, the Middle East and North Africa, which average at 3.53. On average, the world has a democratic score of 5.44, remember, out of 10, meaning as humankind, we're not doing that great when it comes to bringing power to the people. And I think it's from the people themselves that this data might be more accurate. So, using another ranking, the Democracy Perception Index from Dahlia Research, we can see how people in their own country perceive their own regimes. According to this, 78% of people around the world believe democracy is important. The highest result was, curiously, in Greece, with 92% of people stating this. It makes sense, being the birthplace of democracy in ancient times. 40% throughout the world believe their country is not actually fully democratic. They use something called a democratic deficit, which takes the percentage of people in a country which say democracy is important and subtract it with the percentage of people who believe their own country is democratic. Taiwan has the best result, only with a 7% deficit. Philippines, Switzerland, and Denmark follow. However, it's important to note something. These results don't mean a country is democratic. They can also mean that it's not democratic and people just don't care, or that people are not aware of how undemocratic their nation is, despite thinking democracy is important. A good example of this is Saudi Arabia, which ranks very low on the previous ranking, but only has a democratic deficit of 9% in this one. The biggest deficits are found in Venezuela, Poland, and Hungary, where people believe democracy is important, but not fully present in their own countries. And this ranking shows precisely that people want democracy. When asked if they believe there is enough democracy in their own country, a lot of people in countries deemed free said no. Poland, Chile, Brazil, Spain, and Romania have the highest and therefore worst results here. And it's odd how some countries that are effectively and objectively more free have sometimes a higher percentage of its population claiming there still isn't enough democracy. For instance, statistically, the United States have more freedom than Malaysia, according to these rankings, but a higher percentage of Americans believe there still isn't enough democracy, 36%, as opposed to 23% of Malaysians. So, that was a quick look at the most and least democratic countries in the world in 2020, according to these rankings. Although using the data from 2019, because we always need to do this 1 year back in order to be able to access the data which was collected and analyzed throughout the following year. By looking at this, we understand that democracy is present throughout most of the world, but in a lot of cases, not enough. After all, only about half the countries in the world make it into the green, with a great number of the others being in the yellow orange, and a few, sadly, in the red. Although we can be hopeful, those in the yellow might be improving their situation, and as time goes on, we will hopefully have an increasingly free world. Thanks so much for watching this video. Happy holidays. Subscribe if you want and leave a comment below with other indexes or rankings of countries that you think could be interesting to make videos on. I will see you next time for more general knowledge.